Fantastic. Our next speaker is Mr. Govinda Rajan, and what we've asked him to speak on is a corollary to what Ganesh talked about. And as Ganesh was talking about, I was actually thinking of some of the things he said, which are a kind of natural segue into what we had asked Mr. Govinda Rajan to talk about, which is how do you really make the trade-offs? You know, you were talking about the IIT, IIM example. We've actually followed a very similar strategy in our company. In fact, two of our products of that strategy are here. Mahesh and Arjun are here. And Shreyasi, who does the editorial, is also part of a similar strategy. We've taken very young people and given them larger roles. Mm. But the big trade-off is that every time, you know, we do that, we also wish we had more experienced people. And when something doesn't go well, you feel like, oh my God, you know, if we had somebody who had all the experience, then they would have been able to manage it better. So you're constantly trading off. And if you obviously went to hire experienced people, then you will get people who are much more expensive, but who are also not as entrepreneurial and as flexible as you would want to be. So whatever you do, it seems like, you know, you're always constantly making trade-offs. Some of the questions that we asked Mr. Govinda Rajan was really around how do you make some of these trade-offs as you look at your constraints and how to manage those constraints. So I will let him talk about that, but before that, let me just quickly introduce him. He's the co-founder and director of Perfios, and like both Ganesh and I, he's actually a professional who used to work with Tata IBM before he became an entrepreneur. He has a master's in computer science from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst and did his BE from IISc Bangalore right here. But after Tata IBM, he actually founded Aztecsoft, which I think all of you must have heard of, which then got acquired by Mindspring. And I think that's where he really began his entrepreneurial journey as the CTO and the founder of Aztecsoft. And that was his first successful venture. He's now on to his second venture, which is Perfios. And Perfios is a software solution that allows you to manage all your personal finances. So this is a business which I think all of us have you have us all as customers. And I understand that this is all available free of cost to us. So I didn't realize that this was even available. And so I can spend less money on buying all of these personal financial software programs. So with that, may I welcome you, sir, to make some remarks.
Ganesh obviously has a lot more experience in all the successful ventures, so he can kind of philosophize and talk at a much more higher level. Unfortunately for me, this is my actually third venture. The first one was a complete disaster, so 1 year did not go anywhere. That's when I joined IBM, and after that kind of recouped and started Aztec, which was reasonably okay. We went public and all of that, went through a complete life cycle. And this is the third one. So since I'm going through a completely new venture, B2C. I'm a lot more involved in the operational side of things. And so as I'm going through all of that, some of the questions that were sent to me look very, very relevant because I'm actually experiencing all of those constraints. And so to that extent, pardon me if I'm getting into more of operational low-level issues, but I think most of you here would be able to relate to that because I'm sure every one of you would be going through that, whereas unlike a person like Ganesh who has gone through all of this many, many times over, so you may not even want to talk about this, right? So for example, the first thing that all of us have issues at any point in time, whether we are a startup or whether we are a matured company or a large company, is definitely cash flow and the profitability, right? Like one of my board members, Mr. Pai, used to say, your top line is always for vanity, whereas the bottom line is for sanity. So however big you are, while you can talk about like I have 100 million, 1 billion, whatever top line, unless you are going to generate profitable, you may not be profitable today, but at least as an entity, as a business, you're not into charity. So as a business, you have to at least establish ways by which you are demonstrating to your stakeholders that there is a road to profitability. It may not be today, it may be two years down the road, 3 years down the road, but it becomes very critical that this cash flow and profitability are hand in hand together and for any entity that's going to be a constraint that we have to work with. Then Ganesh talked about this focus, and I definitely want to emphasize on that. I feel most of the startups, I mean, all the startups want to start the aim that I'm going to change the world. I will solve world hunger. I will take care of so many things, right? I mean, no one starts with an aim saying, I'm going to be a mediocre company that is going to be languishing in the basement of some commercial complex. Definitely not, right? All of us have a fantastic business plan. We present to VCs. We try to get funding, right? But what happens is during the course of the thing, either because of the cash flow issue or otherwise, we tend to lose that focus. So we tend to get whatever that comes our way because we don't have the cash flow coming in or because of the pressure from our investors or whoever we have taken the money from. There is this focus that gets lost, and we just go and do whatever that can give us that immediate short-term cash relief, right? So once that focus goes away, I think that's where you completely lost the plot. It's going to be very, very difficult for you to get back to what you wanted to do. Like just to corroborate with my previous example of Aspectsoft, so we started that as a product company. This was in 96. We said we will try to build a world-class product because at that time there was no major product company coming out of India. So we said we will build a product that, I mean, people say that India is either a body shopping company in the space of IT, either body shopping, or at most we can do some kind of IT services where we give you the requirements, throw over the wall, you develop code and throw it over. But we said we have enough talent, we have enough people, we can go and build world-class product. So we started the company as like, we are going to be very different. In fact, our first business plan, myself and Partha, who was the co-founder, we wrote saying we won't be an Infosys or a Wipro. That was our first thing, right? So 2 years we struggled building a product. Then we realized technology is only a very small part of being a product company. It requires a lot more than just technology, right? That is when all this cash flow hit us. And we said, let's go and build services, right? So we said we will build this product engineering business. Today it is a very fashionable term to say OPD, and it's a large term that's being used. But at that time, we said we'll go and build this OPD, offshore product development, build engineering services for product companies. Yes, it got us cash flow, and we were quite profitable. We went public, all that. From business angle, from our investors' perspective, we did okay. But what happened was, in the process, it was like riding two ponies. We could never do that. We could never get back to our focus of building a product company, being the one of the best product companies out in the world. We could never achieve that. There is always a regret that we kind of diluted our focus of being a product company and took the easy way out of getting into services. Yes, we built a profitable company and all that returned to our stakeholders, but that initial focus was lost and we could never recover back to take that product space. A couple of things again that was talked about was the talent acquisition, partners and channels. So that's a very, very key thing, especially as a startup early stage company which we are going through today. Is there is no way I can go and match, as Ganesh was alluding to, there's no way we can match the salaries of any of these larger companies. I'll touch upon this in a later slide, where what are some of the things that we are doing. Partners and channels are other very interesting. I'm sure you can relate to this. You go and talk to a potential partner or a channel, so they will dismiss you. They won't even want to meet you. Right? They'll say you are one small non-entity, why should I even partner with you? But that becomes critical for you in order to get to a reach, especially in a B2C kind of a space that we are in. It's going to be extremely difficult for us to go and reach out to the 10 million user base that we want to address. So I need to partner with a bank. I need to partner with some large financial institution. So what are some of those constraints within which you are to work where they find a value in partnering with you? And then this external perception becomes extremely important, whether you want to raise funding or you want to go IPO or you want to attract talent. Each one of this, that is a constraint that you have to work with. And the other interesting thing that we find is the new growth engines, especially when you, let's say, you are on your growth path and you want to accelerate. Obviously, with a single product, you find that you cannot really grow that much. You want a 200%, 300% growth, right, in the initial stages, right? So what are the new growth engines that you have to find? And you have only a certain amount of cash with you. You have only a certain amount of people that can work on it. So how do you identify this growth engines, and within the constraint that you have, how do you kind of still have the achieve the same level of growth? And fundraising is eternal constraint that you have to work with because you don't have enough cash, and there are not many people that are willing to kind of put in the money that you want, right? And at some point in time, you have to definitely talk about your exit and M&A. It's not like while in the business plan you talk about like I want to build a multi-billion dollar company for the next 20 years solving world hunger. Well, that is good for a marketing plan. I mean, you need to, for the interest of the investors and stakeholders, look at a very pragmatic exit option also at various points. And that becomes one of the parameters within which you have to work. And this leads to a question of all these constraints invariably leads to conflicts. Because it's not like any one of this is wrong or right, but how do you kind of, given the various constraints that you have, how do you manage all these conflicts so that your overall initial goal of trying to solve world hunger is still met? So the first conflict is always this growth versus available capital. Like all of us go through that, right? Like you have certain amount of money available to you, a few millions or a few crores or whatever it is, but then you want to do so many things. You want to go to so many markets. You want to go to so many different segments, right? Demography, various things. But you don't have that kind of capital available to you. So what is it that you want to balance there? Whether it is growth with the kind of capital that you have or focus on specific territory. So all that becomes an interesting conflict to manage. From an engineering perspective, some of you here are engineers, you can relate to this very easily. Like you will always find a pushback from your engineering team saying, this is the next greatest Google that I'm building, right? But at the same time, the sales and marketing guy will come back and say, no one cares about this. All I'm interested is this particular nifty feature you introduced in last release, if you can make it much more usable, that will give us 100,000 more users. Why do you want to go and build the next Google? No one even is worrying about it. So how do you balance this conflict between your typical engineering team that is trying to build the next possible best gizmo in the town versus your sales and marketing team that is saying, all we are interested is in acquiring some more users who can pay for your bills. So this is a classic thing that all of us go through, scaling up versus profitability. Like we constantly get into, even in my earlier company as well as in today's company, in the board meeting, invariably this comes around to this, where certain set of people coming from the background that they are, they will talk about profitability. So as I said, this person continuously say, your bottom line is sanity, not the top line, right? So how do you ensure that you build a business first to profitable level and then move up? There is the other school of thought that says you cannot be waiting for that to happen. Like as Ganesh was saying, like you cannot keep on building only for profitability because the world would have moved on. Like he was, most of his business, he was the first guy who was doing that, right? So he had that first mover advantage. But that first mover advantage may not be there forever, right? You need still a window of an opportunity, and there may be other people who are trying to enter the market. So there, the other school of thought is like, just go and scale up, and then hopefully certain profitability plans will emerge out of that, certain business model will emerge out of that. Obviously, there is a fault in that also, as we have seen in the dot-com bust, when you keep building, but no business came and you have to fold. So that is a classic case, especially when you are working with a VC firm or external investors. That is something that we need to constantly keep addressing. This relates to the focused offering, which I just touched upon in the case of Aztec. Just because there is some easy cash flow, many times that may turn out to be a wrong thing for you. And it may not be the right thing from a long-term to medium-term perspective of the organization. So the next one, again, from an engineering perspective, the build versus buy. Ashok was also touching upon in his keynote speech. Invariably, your engineers will come back and say, I can do this much, much better at a cheaper price than what you are getting it done from a partner. But do you have the bandwidth? Because you want to focus on very different things. You want your best engineer to be focusing on something else. And same thing, whether it's marketing or sales or any of the functions, HR. So do you want to do it in-house? Do you want to partner? And finally, for most of these conflicts, I think if you focus on just these three keywords, like the cash flow, the focus, and profitability, most of these conflicts can naturally get resolved. So for example, if you know this is the kind of cash flow I want, so then you will automatically answer the question, do we have the wherewithal to do this kind of growth engines, the new growth engines that I want to add to my system? So most of the questions will get answered if you have asked these questions, and the conflicts can, in most of the cases, be addressed. The other interesting thing that all of us go through is, in terms of, this was touched upon, how do you acquire good talent for your startup entity? You cannot obviously afford the price that a top MNC is giving. So how do you do this? So you want long-term motivation, not just having a party and then during that day the employees are motivated, because with the hangover, that motivation also goes away, right, after the hangover. So you want long-term motivation, and you want consistent high morale, especially in this thing where window of opportunity is limited. You want to build the best possible widget and then get out to the market as quickly as possible. So a consistent high morale and high productivity is required. And obviously, since your cash flow is limited, you have to somehow try to get more for less. So how do you achieve all of this? So one of the learnings for us was definitely you can attract people with high quality work. Again, as Ganesh mentioned, like attraction, like working directly with the CEO or getting to do the latest work with your executive management. So this applies. But I think what worked for us in Aztec and in my current entity is a high level of ownership and ESOP. Like when we went public in 2000, one of the criticism that we faced in roadshows when we went and talked to all the analysts and potential investors was that you guys are giving away too much to employees. Like we had 30% as ESOP at the time of going public, and that was one of the highest at that time. So IT&T was around the same time we went public. So 30% was the ESOP, maybe the same week. So 30% was our ESOP, and that was the highest. And people said you are just giving away too much of money. But our contention was these are the people that are actually bringing value to the system in the medium to long term, not just short term. So we need to reward them. That's the primary way to motivate. Because while we say people are motivated by high quality work and the ability to work directly with management and all that, at the end of it, people still are looking at their bank balances. They want to see if I'm comparing myself with another guy who is working in, at that time, maybe IBM or Microsoft, am I making more or less or whatever? So an ESOP obviously is a great way to, one, add a sense of ownership because they know they're working for themselves instead of working for someone else. And second thing is if we do make it, then obviously there is a significant monetary upside. And fortunately for us, a lot of people in Aztec made reasonably good. And about 20-25 folks in early 30s retired within quotes because they were able to afford to take that kind of a position. And interestingly, some of them have joined me back in the new venture because they know that there is some amount of track record and hopefully if you do a reasonably good job of execution, they can again afford to retire once more, right? So even in the current entity when we structured ESOP on day one when we floated the company. And even here, we have something like 30-31% of the company that is owned by employees. Because we feel combination of good work and a monetary upside is the primary reason by which you can attract good talent, retain good talent, and address all of those motivation issues. So what I feel is while, yes, there are lots of constraints that are there in running a startup and taking to the next level, as Ganesh also observed, most of these constraints can be turned to your advantage to be made more like an opportunity. For instance, to start with fiscal prudence. I mean, you know that if you blow up too much, next month you don't have money in your bank to pay for your employees. So obviously there is an inbuilt fiscal prudence in your system from day one. You don't have a choice, right? Which is always good. Second is, again, because of limited constraints, limited people that you have, you need to innovate on technology. You need to do things very differently than what is being done by some of the larger entity with a huge amount of budgets, which in itself will lead to better products, better gizmos that you are building. Obviously a much smaller and leaner organization, and overall a much more motivated workforce. Because the way people look at it is, we are a small 15-20 people organization, we are able to beat, within quotes, something of that big company, right? So that kind of a motivation, that kind of a sense of achievement can come in with this set of constraints and if they're able to deliver with this. So what we feel is, yes, there are constraints, but all of them, if it is done properly, if it is executed properly with proper external advisory boards and guidance, can actually lead to more opportunities and strategies for us. Thank you.